Okay, good morning to all of you. So sorry for the technical hitch. So I'm speaking on the role of laboratory animals in preclinical studies. Next slide, please. So as you are aware, in any drug development, preclinical studies plays a very crucial role. It's a stage of research that begins before the initiation of clinical trials. So I'll come to that, what kind of clinical trials we have. But preclinical studies before a clinical trial. So basically, these are conducted to define the pharmacological and toxicological effects prior to the initiation on human beings. So basically, to assess the toxicity and efficacy. So both here in preclinical studies, we both use in vitro and in vivo studies basically to determine the safety and efficacy of the compounds. Next. Yeah, next slide.
Yeah.
Okay. So this is just a diagram which typically shows the drug discovery process. So typically, a drug which synthesized today, so it will take minimum 10 to 15 years to come to the market. This is how the process goes on. So for target identification, usually we require up to 1 year, and then for target validation, again another 1 year, and again lead identification, another 1 year, and optimization for another 2 to 3 years. And after that, so only it will go to preclinical trial. So that usually takes 1 to 2 years. And after the preclinical trial, it will go for a human trial. So that's a clinical trial. That anyway takes between 4 to 6 years, depending upon the situation. So basically, so we need at least 10 to 15 years to develop one drug to come to the market, actually. So these are traditional drug discovery process, but sometimes we circumvent this process also in case of a pandemic, like I'll come to that later. Pandemic situation, there are methods so that we can avoid certain steps here. Next. So this is again a drug discovery process, as I said. So basically, we synthesize thousands of compounds every day, but not all the compounds come to the preclinical trial. So for example, this is just a gist in this diagram, it's shown here. So anywhere between 5 to 10,000 compounds, if it is discovered, so only 250 will achieve the preclinical trial. So rest all will be eliminated before the preclinical trial itself, based upon their toxicity and other parameters. So it will be eliminated. Only 250 will come out of 10,000, and out of 250, only 5 will go to the clinical trial. So again, so there will be phase 1, phase 2, and phase 3. But when it goes for a FDA approval, so out of these 5, only 1 will go ultimately. So again, so the year has been year for this development process is shown at the bottom. So 3 to 6 years here, and 6 to 7 years clinical trials, and FDA approval again typically 1 year to 2 years. Next. So in drug discovery process, we follow three different types of practices. One is a good manufacturing practice, good clinical practice, and good laboratory practice. So here, mostly we follow good laboratory practice in preclinical trials. But good manufacturing practice also starts from the day of synthesizing itself. But GLP starts up to the preclinical stage. After that, it will be good clinical practice. In this, you can see what are the different areas what we cover. In the red box, you can see different types of studies which are conducted in preclinical development stages. Okay, next. So next, there are different phases of drug development. So typically, so we classify them as 5 different stages. One is identify, first you have to identify a drug target, and second one is you have to develop a bioassay to check that particular drug, and you have to screen the drug in that particular assay system what you have developed, and establish the effective and the toxic doses. That is the fourth stage, and finally you have to file this compound as an investigation new drug to the regulatory authority. So I'll go one by one in the next slide. Okay, next slide. So in the step one, so first we have to identify a drug target. So drug targets are specific points in the biochemical pathways. So here one typical flow chart is shown here. So these are series of chemical reactions occurring within a cell. So in each pathway, the principal chemical is modified into by chemical reactions. So well, for example, A to B, B to C, C to D. So these are different reactions. So we don't know where exactly our drug is targeting. So any step in this pathway, for example, A to B, B to C might be a target. So this target identification is a very challenging task. So first you have to do, so where exactly your drug is acting, and then it will go to the next step. Next slide, please. So after identifying a particular target, then you have to develop a bioassay for that. So bioassay basically is a live system, so that can be used to measure the drug effect. So it may be a culture of cells or organs or a whole animal. So anything it could be. So basically we use cell cultures at initial stages, only animal studies will come at a later stage. For example, zebrafish is now commonly being used to develop bioassays, basically to see the effect of drugs on bone density, blood vessel growth, etc., etc. Because these are the resources are plentiful and not much animal activism is also there. So for that reason, zebrafish is being used in large numbers. Next. Okay. The third step is screening the drug. So whatever you develop the bioassay, then what you have to do that actual test of the particular drug, you have to test it on the particular bioassay what you have developed. So basically this will determine whether the drug is safe and whether it is effective in the bioassay or not. So it will tell you, it will give you some clue actually basically. Okay, next. The fourth step is you have to establish the effective and the toxic dose. This is a critical phase where a lot of preclinical studies lies in this stage. So what dosage of the drug is safe and what drug is toxic and what are the side effects, all those things should be studied in this fourth step. Next. Next is the last step. So that will be just applying to the regulatory authority. So what you have to do here is actually you have to convince the regulatory authorities that how your drug compound is IND is manufactured and how it appears. Like you have to show them that the color, solubility, melting point, particle size, moisture content, everything you have to determine and you have to convince the regulatory authority. Next, you have to also show them how it is formulated. If it is a formulation, then you have to show them it is a, whether it is a pill or it is a liquid. So that kind of information you have to provide to them. And next, how it will be analyzed for purity and concentration and stability. This is very critical and you have to convince the regulatory authority beyond doubt that so these are the exact methods what we are following to determine the compound what you have developed. And finally, that will be tested for safety in any animals. This is basically the basis for allowing first use in humans. That means before clinical trial, so the safety test has to be done on animals and you have to submit to the regulatory authority for the approval. Next. So the goal of preclinical studies is basically to identify initial safe dose and identify the target organs for toxicity. So some drugs may be toxic to liver, kidney. So all these things has to be determined in the toxicity studies. And then the next goal is to study such toxicity, whether it is reversible or not. So now in preclinical studies, we also use reversibility studies to make sure if the effect persists, how long it will persist, and how whether it is reversible, how soon it will come back to normalcy. That kind of information you have to provide to the regulatory authority. And again, identify safe parameters for clinical monitoring. So what are the parameters? So those things also you have to determine and show it to the regulatory authority. Next. So yeah, basically in preclinical studies, so we use almost all sorts of pharmacological parameters. One is pharmacodynamic studies. So here, these pharmacodynamic studies will provide evidence for the desired biological effect of a drug. So that can be determined by this method. And it also provides insight into the potential toxicity of, to establish a human starting dose. So this is the basis. And after that, then we'll go for pharmacokinetic studies. So this will basically all you know that absorption, tissue distribution, metabolism, excretion, and volume of distribution, half-life, all these things are determined or quantified and used as a next step for our safety study. Next. And next step is screening. So you have to develop either simple or rapidly performed tests to indicate the presence or absence of a particular. That means, as I said earlier, bioassay system, you have to develop an assay, and in that assay, you have to show how the compound is behaving. And either it can be done on isolated organs also, basically to study the activity, and also on bacterial cultures. Basically, the mutagenicity studies are done using various types of bacteria. I'll come to that later. So bacterial culture also will give a lot of clues about the genetic mutation. This is also a very important step in the preclinical study. And finally, the animal models. So there are various disease models are also available in preclinical studies. But in case of GLPs, we use only conventional animal models. We don't use any knockouts or transgenic models. I'll come to that also in subsequent slides. Next. In preclinical studies, we also determine the mechanism of action. So we have to show that how this compound is behaving, how it's acting in a particular system, and whether what kind of activity it has, whether it's antihypertensive action, anti-inflammatory, RAAs, etc., etc. And so you have to determine this thing. And after that, you have to do systemic pharmacology. That means how this compound acts on the major organs, such as nervous system or cardiovascular, respiratory, renal, etc. This has to be determined and submitted to the regulatory authority with valid proof. Again, quantitative test you have to do, dose response relationship, maximal effect, and comparative efficacy, and existing drugs, with existing drugs, it has to be carried out. And you have to show the supremacy of the particular the new compound under investigation over the existing compound. And the next one is a toxicity test. So we use different types of toxicity like acute, subacute, chronic, and teratogenicity, oncogenicity. All these things are determined in preclinical. And again, confirmatory tests, like any active compound taken up for this, so whatever you have developed, so it will be taken up for more elaborate studies in the later stages, actually. And you have to characterize with more accuracy. Next. Now, actual role of animals comes in the preclinical studies. As you know, sir, every medical advancement in the last century depended directly or indirectly on the animals. So none of the compounds what we are using actually right now has come without testing on animals. Almost all so we have tested on animals before coming to human usage. So basically animals provide whole organism knowledge, and that cannot be replicated right now with any other way right now. So we have a lot of alternate systems. I'll come to that at a later stage. Even though we have a lot of alternatives, but that will not give you a whole organism knowledge. Basically, kinetic studies and dynamic studies is impossible to study in alternate system. So that's why animals are very, very critical till today, probably future also. So we don't know. Next. So why animals are used in research? So this is very important because very limited number of studies can be done on humans. A lot of ethical issues are concerned with humans. So that's why we cannot straight away use the compounds or drugs in humans. So for that reason, we do preclinical studies. Basically, most of the animals, the physiology and anatomy can be matched to humans. That animals, more or less, for example, if you take the mouse, more than 99% genetic similarity is there between the mouse and the human beings. So they are good models, but they may not be 100% similar to anatomy in terms of anatomy and physiology. And different animals we use, that's the reason actually. And again, some animals are susceptible for the disease that affect human beings also. For example, so we have a lot of wild animals. For example, cat is one good animal model that gets asthma like what we get in. And like there is an Irish setter dog, so that has actually factor 8 actually that is responsible for inducing hemophilia. So they do get hemophilia in natural actually, so these dogs. So they are all good models, but it's very rare to get those animals. These are some of the examples that I'm telling. And some animals, they do get same kind of disease what we get actually. So they can also be used for studies. And also another issue is short lifespan. That is the greatest advantage with these animals. For example, if you have to do some reproductive toxicology studies, teratogenesis studies, so in case of human beings, you have to wait for several years. Whereas in case of rats and mice, it can be done within a span of 1 year to 1.5 years. So that's the greatest advantage with these animals. Next. And again, the animals will allow controlled experiments. That means so you can control the environmental variables like temperature, humidity, and also feeding and watering conditions. Everything you can control, and you can conduct the experiment under uniform conditions. Whereas in human beings, it's not possible because human population is heterogeneous population. Whereas in animals, we use basically, see, we use homogeneous animals. So that means the variables are very less actually in case of animals compared to humans. And again, so dosage, route of exposures can be controlled or varied in case of animals. That means suppose if some experiment goes bad, so you can repeat it. So whereas in human beings, we can't do that kind of mistakes. That is the greatest advantage. So that means you can replicate the experiments if something goes wrong also in animals. That's an advantage here. Again, next. Actually, so regulators ask the data in two species when you're submitting the compound. Basically, we see, as I said earlier, so we see a lot of species difference because animals are not the exact replica of human beings. So there will be a lot of difference. So to minimize that difference, so we use two different species. One is basically rodent. So most common choice is the rat is the most common choice. And second one is the non-rodent. So dog and the non-human primates are also commonly being used. But nowadays, mini pig has replaced this dog in most of the CROs. So now it's an excellent model as a non-rodent species. Next. In preclinical studies, actually, in the document number one, so in section one, it has been very clearly mentioned what type of animals, plants, bacteria, and cells to be used in determining the efficacy of these compounds. So you have to use only those things which are mentioned in that particular section, and then you have to conduct experiments as per the guidelines mentioned in the OECD documents. Next. Basically, this GLP or what we say OECD documents helps us in determining the various toxicities. So there we have acute toxicity profile studies, chronic toxicity profiles, and different dose levels what we have to select while determining the toxicity. One is below and one is above or normal and well above the human dose. So three different doses we have to select. Again, to select the dose, there are different guidelines. So we have to use that guideline, and then you have to determine the dose, and then the dose which is non-toxic, then that has to be used in these kind of studies. Three different doses. Next. So basically, the OECD guidelines are mainly aim to determine the safety of the chemicals and also to safety of the environment also and safety of human beings and animals. So these guidelines are related to acute toxicity, chronic toxicity, reproductive toxicity, and dermal irritation. All these things we use laboratory animals in large quantities. Next. Again, even in India also, so CDSCO has some guidelines under the Drugs and Cosmetics Rules 1945. So we have a guidance called Schedule Y. So there also there's a reference how to conduct a single dose toxicity studies, repeat dose and teratogenicity studies, and what number of animals you have to use for these kind of studies. So these are also accepted by the Indian regulator, the Schedule Y guidelines. Next. And apart from that, so there is one very good reference book by Shane, actually. So there we have clearly determined what are the animal models commonly being used in toxicology studies. In single dose toxicity, it may be repeat dose toxicity or toxicokinetic and pharmacokinetic studies, safety pharmacology. For all these things, so you have different models and how we have to conduct the studies. All these things are very well explained in that book. If you happen to, you can download from the net also. I think this book may be available freely. You can go through that for more information. Next. So basically, the number of and type of studies required depending upon the therapeutic indication. So for example, as I said earlier, so in case of if it's a life-threatening illness, so it requires fewer studies to reach the clinic. In case of this whatever we have, this pandemic right now, COVID, so we have circumvented a lot of preclinical studies. It has directly gone to human beings for clinical trials. So regulatory authority will take a decision or take a call. Which is really required and which is not required in such situation, and then they will decide and then they will release the compound to the market or human use. So in general, okay, just go back. So animal studies are conducted in two species, as I said earlier. One is one rodent and one non-rodent. And biologicals may require only one species. So nowadays, we are, a lot of biologics are there in the market. So here also, we don't require two species. Only one is that's the regulator's opinion. Next. Again, usually the preclinical safety studies start with single dose, either acute or range finding studies, and then you determine the most appropriate dose range in the particular species what we are testing, and then you get an idea of the target organs and include the minimum number of animals for the evaluation. So first you have to determine the particular safe dose, and then you have to use for toxicity studies. Next. The next step is the repeat dose toxicity studies. Here, for small molecules, as I said earlier, two species. For biologics, only one species is required as per the regulator's requirement. And this, whatever the compound what you are using here, it should your experimental design should be in such a way that it should mimic the human ultimate use. Like the root what we are using, it should be similar to human being. So same root you have to use in animals. And the duration and the schedule. So it should mimic the human system as much as possible when you are designing the experiment in animals. Next. Again, in repeat dose toxicity, so extensive evaluations will be done on the toxic effects for body waves or clinical signs of toxicity. And there is a lot of battery of tests, even including the central nervous system tests, actually. Clinical pathology, histopathology, food consumption. So everything, there'll be more than 30, 40 parameters. So we have to look into it in this repeat dose toxicity studies. And then we have to come to conclusion whether that compound is toxic or not to the animal. And again, at least one dose should be produced, the dose limiting toxicity, and one dose should be non-toxic so in this repeat dose toxicity. Next. And apart from that, so we use other methods also other than animals. For example, physical chemical testing. So we have to characterize a particular compound, and we have to do 5-batch analysis, like viscosity, density, pH of the particular compound. All these things has to be determined before being used on animals. First, analytical testing has to be done, and again you have to develop a method, as I said earlier, and you have to validate that method, and again you have to check the stability and the homogeneity of the compound. So that is very, very important, stability checking and homogeneity. So how long, suppose if you reconstitute a particular compound in a solvent, so how long that is stable and whether it will be homogeneous throughout. So that first has to be determined before using it on animals. Again, dose confirmation analysis, all these things comes under physical chemical testing. So this has to be determined before the animal studies. Next. And after that, so all these are all the various types of studies, acute oral, acute dermal, inhalation studies, eye irritation, local tolerance test, lymph node assay. Next. And under subacute, so we have 7-day repeat dose toxicity and 14-day, 28-day, 42-day, and under chronic, so 90-day repeat dose toxicity. So all these tests are not necessary under each category, so you can do one depending upon the need actually. Next. Again, toxicity studies. So again, we have a lot of in vitro models, in vitro skin irritation, in vitro cytotoxicity, in vitro phototoxicity, and neurotoxicity studies. And apart from that, we some compounds we have to do this development and reproductive toxicity also. Then again, there are three different models, segment 1, segment 2, segment 3. So in segment 1, just fertility study is tested, whereas in segment 2, so embryo fetal toxicity or developmental toxicity is determined, whereas in segment 3, so it's more elaborative. So here we do pre and postnatal and maternal toxicity also we determine and then submit the data to regulators. Next. And as I said earlier, so mutagenicity study also is a very important step in the preclinical study. So here also we use animals also, in vivo studies are also there. But in some, we don't use any animals, like BRMT, bacterial reverse mutation test, commonly it's called Ames test. So here we use the different bacterial strains, and again, chromosomal aberration test, that we use animals also in determining. this chromosome aberration, and micronucleus actually. Here also both in vivo and in vitro tests are there as per the OECD guidelines. So you can determine whichever is more convenient, appropriate for that particular compound, and gene mutation assay. So these are four different tests commonly being employed to determine the mutagenicity of a particular compound. Next. Again, apart from that, so OECD is also important, even in preclinical studies basically. So environmental toxicity is also very, very important. So when you are developing a compound, not only to the humans, but this compound should not contaminate the environment also. So for that, so we have a lot of other test systems, we call it as. For example, we use plants, and we use birds, we use honeybees, insects, other things, even fish also we use. And we determine the toxicity. So that compound what you develop should not contaminate the environment also. So for that, we have to determine the toxicity in these kind of species. One is alga growth inhibition test, Daphnia. So these are plants actually basically. And earthworm, suppose if the compound is, whatever the compound is toxic to the soil, so then we have to determine the earthworm toxicity test. And honeybee, suppose if the compound is toxic to the air, then we have to determine that honeybee aflatoxicity. So basically these are all for agrochemicals, may not be for human drugs, but it's must for the agrochemicals basically. And acute fish toxicity and even acute toxicity depending upon the thing and application. Again, apart from that, so we have types of studies, preclinical studies, earlier toxic kinase stimulation analysis, analytical method development, chemocompatibility, in vitro skin and in vitro cytochrome P450 and induction, and biocompatibility studies, bioassays. All these things are also part of preclinical research. Next. These are the commonly being used animal species and also some plant species in preclinical studies. Rat is the most commonly used. We use Pygdalli and Wistar, and mouse we use Balb-C, Swiss albino C57 and CD1. We don't use any knockouts or specific models in preclinical studies, especially the regulatory studies. Otherwise, in basic research, we use highly specific disease models. I'll come to that later. Rabbits are also being used, like New Zealand white rabbit, guinea pig, earthworm and fish, honeybee, chicken, quails, turkey, and also pigeon, and last two are plant species, alga and Daphnia. Okay. So these are all biological test system. We use a lot of bacterial strains for in vitro studies, basically to understand the mutagenicity of that particular compound, like TA100, TA98, this all Salmonella typhinium, and 1535, TA1537, and E. coli. So these are the substrates in that particular bacteria we use to understand the genetic mutation. Next. And apart from that, we use a lot of cell lines, basically derived from either animals or even from humans also, we use in preclinical studies, like Chinese hamster cell, kidney cells, cell lines, Balb-3T3 cell line, and L51, V79, L29, 929. So these are all derived from mouse and reconstructed human epidermis. Basically, it's from the human, and cornea like epithelium, and CaCO2 cell line. These are all some of the cell lines I have listed here. Mostly derived from animals or from human beings. Okay, next. And this just different test guidelines what listed in the OECD, that 478 is basically to check the rodent dominant lethal test, and again 417 is the toxicokinetics, and 403 is acute inhalation toxicity, and 407 is commonly applied for repeated dose 28-day toxicity in rodents. Next. Again, the 409 is another test window. There are different, there are more than 100 tests are there in OECD. Again, I'm restricting only to the animals and the plants. Not all I'm mentioning here. And 409 is a repeat dose to 90-day toxicity in non-rodents, basically for the dogs. And again, 223 is again commonly for, used in Japanese quail oral toxicity test. Next. 237 is basically for the larval toxicity test in honeybees, and 214 again honeybees acute contact toxicity test. Next. And this again, these are also very important to fish embryo acute toxicity test. Test guideline is 236 and earthworm toxicity is 207. Next. And these two are plants, 211 Daphnia magna, and another one is freshwater alga. So that is a test guideline 201. So these are also commonly being employed in GLP. Next. And apart from that, we have a lot of in vitro models nowadays, even that is validated and approved by the OECD. One is 442D, basically for the in vitro skin sensitization studies, we use that model. And 438, so we use isolated chicken eye test actually. So this is also approved by OECD. So these are all alternate methods we consider. Next. And apart from that, as I said earlier, so these are all animals or plant species or birds in regulated studies. Apart from that, we also use specific models in preclinical research. These are very valuable, but very expensive to undertake that kind of studies actually. Next. For example, for cardiovascular research, so we have plenty of models, mouse models are there. So initial testing of your compounds, you can use them. But regulators will not accept this kind of thing because this not been validated by the this organization. So that's the reason. So they don't accept this as a regulatory model. So in the regulatory model, I already mentioned the common conventional strains only being used. But these models, we can initially for preclinical screening, you can use these models. So these are various type of model like 11BHSD mouse model, B6 C3F1 model, CB6. And the purpose also is given on the right side, like for cardiac hypertrophy and heart failure, PHSD2 model is a very good model. And for LOX1 mouse, again, a good cardiovascular model. And for cholesterol regulation, the PCSK9 mouse model is a very good model. And there are a couple of vendors, international vendors, like Jackson model, Harlan, or Taconet. So there are more than 3,000 specific models are available in the market. So you have to do a lot of homework before selecting particular model for your experimentation. Okay, next. Similarly for CNS, so we have various models for Alzheimer's disease. We have specific models, NSE-P25 and peak glycoprotein mouse model, basically for CNS transport, excretion involving multiple drug sensitive compounds, all these things you can use this kind of models. Okay, next. And diabetes model, so we have various models. I think most commonly in pharmacy colleges or veterinary colleges, so we use only the ceftazocin and alexin induced diabetes model. But that is not the exact model because in humans, we don't get the diabetes instantaneously. Because whereas in case of chemically induced diabetes, we get the diabetes within 48 to 72 hours. So that's not an exact or similar model. So hence, that is not considered a good model actually for understanding the mechanism or this. So for that, scientists have developed a lot of models. They have identified particular genes and they have either knocked in or knocked out some of those things in these animals, and they serve as excellent models for diabetes. For example, if a human being gets diabetes at the age of 40, so similarly these knockout mice, they develop diabetes as the age advances. For example, 8 months or 9 months of their age is equivalent to 50 years of human age. At that time, so these animals will start showing diabetes. So then they are really good models, so we can use those things for the studies. So similarly, so we have a GK model, and again GSK B3 model and Levi-Strat and Rip Hat model. These are all excellent models for the diabetes apart from the conventional science what we are using. Next. And again for metabolism and regulation, so we have again for oncology, so we have nude mice, I think. And again C57, C6 elite mouse for multi-purpose model, we call it as obesity and efficacy testing and immunology. For almost all things, C57 is commonly being used. And so we have Zucker rat, so that's obese model, so that's a very good model to check the glucose intolerance or metabolic syndrome or genetic obesity. So these are highly specific models. Okay, next. Again, for immunologists, we have plenty of models to understand the immunology in the body. B6, S10, 39A mouse model, and again B6, D9, 10A mouse model, brown Norway rat, so, and again HSD11, B1 mouse, and Levi's rat. So these are all commonly being employed for immunological research. Next. So oncology models, right now so we are all using atomic nude mice. I think you are all aware that animal actually do not have any B cell. Their thymus is ablated. So they are a very good model. So whenever you xenograft to these animals, they adapt very well, and tumor growth is very fast in these animals. And non-skid mice is much more better than the nude mice, because both B and T lymphocytes will not be there. And but the maintenance of these skid mice and the nude mice is very, very tough. We have to maintain them in 100% sterile atmosphere, and we need IVC cages and completely class 1 lakh facility for the maintenance of these animals. Otherwise, they will not survive because they are highly immune compromised. And apart from that, we also have some AKR mouse and BDIX rat. So these are all very good models for the oncology. Okay, next. And for kidney research or renal systems, we have various models like DAL, salt rat, and PTK rat, and SHROB rat, FHH rat. So these are different models developed by various organizations like Jackson and other things. They do have the repository, and you can procure from them. Next. And apart from that, so we use a lot of alternate methods in preclinical testing, as I said earlier, so because there is a lot of animal activism is going on all around the globe. So scientists are facing a lot of problems, and also to avoid the wrath of these people, so a lot of alternate methods have been developed and validated, and some of them already been approved by the OECD also. Next. So as I said earlier, so we are facing a lot of problems from the animal activists. They say that animal research is waste and misleading, according to them actually. But scientists say that animal research is vital to medicine. So a lot of debate is going on. So we'll not get into that mode actually now. So we know that right now animal model cannot be replaced with any other model. Okay, next. So actually what the scientists say that human life has greater intrinsic value than animal life, and we have good legislation that protects all experimental animals from cruelty or ill treatment. And again, millions of animals we are killing every year for food. So why can't we use few animals for experimentation? That's the argument from the scientific community. And also they do accept that few animals feel pain and are killed before they are suffered, because we have a lot of guidelines nowadays. So we don't allow animals to suffer excessive pain. So certainly we euthanize them when really animal feels pain. So this is a scientist's argument. Next. But opponents say that no, animals have as much right as we have. So we should not use them for any experimentation. And even though we have strict controls, but they have not prevented some animals from being abused. Though such instances are very rare actually. So it is true also, because some on and off we see in media saying that animals are being abused. So in such cases, there are laws, and that will the prevailing laws will take action on those culprits. But animal activists make this as a big issue, and they try to stop animal experimentation in some places. And again, animals suffer while they are locked up, and how do we know when they do and they don't feel pain? This is not correct because right now we have a lot of the technology is advanced and so we have a lot of mechanism to identify pain in animal, and certainly this will be taken care while conducting experimentation. Next. So because of them, so a lot of alternative methods have come into practice now. A lot of scientific and technical advancement happened. So the greatest advantage of this will reduce the cost and also the reproducibility and rapidity of the experiment. So it will enhance all these things. And also this will actually, the 3R principle, so what proposed by the Russell and Bunch, while conducting the experiments, you have to employ all these 3 R's. One is the replacement, reduction, and refinement. So alternate methods certainly will give more importance for these 3 R principles, so that animal usage will come down enormously. So the outcome is again new alternative methods, but not at the expense of human safety. That's very important. So not all alternate methods are extrapolatable to human beings. So some of them are certainly yes, but some of them are not. Okay, next. For example, so if you are using in silico modeling, there are softwares right now. So most of the big pharmaceutical companies, they have software. So TopCat is one of the software. That's what I heard actually. So if you feed the data of the compound what you have synthesized, the chemical formula, the, automatically the computer will tell you whether that compound is toxic or not. So on ED50 LD50 value it will give. So based on that, so you can delete at that stage itself. So in silico model, so thousands of compounds you can screen at a time, and in vitro model 100 compounds, and alternate methods or models like fish or Drosophila, earthworm, so 10 compounds, whereas in vivo model only one compound. So that's why how precious our animal models are. So you have to use it very judiciously when you are using the next. And you know, as I said earlier, OECD also has approved a lot of in vitro models. All this has been tested and validated and approved by them also. So for skin absorption, so 428 is a test guideline number, and skin irritation and skin corrosion. So here, so various models are, one is a 430, 435, 431, 439, 4020. All these are the test guidelines. Commonly being employed to determine the preclinical toxicity in animals, alternate models. And again, in vitro phototoxicity, we use the 3T3 NRO cell line. The test guideline is 432. Again, skin sensitization, so we use local lymph node assay. And again, in chemical skin sensitization, that's 442C. And also, we use BRDO ELISA assay. So, they again, is an alternate method, model. And again, we use receptors, HeLa cell line we are using to detect estrogen receptor agonist and antagonist. So the models, what we use, 455 and 457. Again, for steroidogenesis assays, we have 456 is the OECD guideline. So that's all acceptable to the OECD. So if you use these alternate models. Again, in vitro ocular corrosion and severe irritation tests. So we use MDCK tubular epithelial cell lines. Next. Again, so I said, this already have mentioned that bacterial reverse mutation is a 471. Again, alternative models, mammalian chromosomal aberration 473, cell gene mutation is 476, and cell micronucleus is 487. And apart from that, so we have reconstructed human cornea like epithelial for the detection of chemicals. So this is actually the test guideline is 491. Similarly, so we have in vitro thymidine kinase mutation test. So it's 492. This is OECD guideline number. Next. And apart from that, so we use a lot of ecotoxicology models. So like earthworm, terrestrial plants, honeybees, plant species like Lamna, Gibba, and fish. So these are all the guidelines. I'll not go into that details. You can get it from the OECD website if you want more information. Next. Yeah, recently they have added these two important models, the epiocular corneal model. Actually, it consists of normal human derived epidermal keratinocytes which have been cultured to form stratified squamous epithelial similar to that of found in the cornea. this is actually accepted by the OECD. So as an alternate method for eye irritation, because now the European Union have banned the eye irritation test in rabbits. All these cosmetic companies are facing a lot of problem because so that's why this model, so it's a boon for them, so they can check the cosmetics on these alternate methods and then get the approval from the regulatory authority. So this allows topical testing of undiluted or water insoluble materials, both epiocular and the rabbit cornea. Next. You can see epidermal skin heterogeneity model is also approved by the OECD. So this is again different cell lines we are using to test the trace heterogeneity of the compound. Next. So we have a lot of high throughput screening nowadays. Actually, so still it's under validation. For example, so if you have to take a rat or mouse and expose them and for crude synaptic membrane from different parts of the brain, and you have to radio ligand and specific neurotransmitter to do the receptor assay. In a conventional method, whereas in case of if you high throughput this thing, so we can use the cultures. Instead of euthanizing the rat or mouse, taking the, you can take the culture and use the same thing, the high throughput machines, so that you can avoid euthanizing the animals. Basically, this is again still under validation only. Next, okay, these are some of the again in vitro toxicology models what we are using, but and still under validation. Probably in another 3 to 4 years, I think. All these preclinical studies may be approved by the regulatory authorities. One is the genotoxicity studies by micronucleus and comet assay, and immunotoxicity, stem cell derived from dendritic cells, and neurotoxicity, phototoxicity. Again, this is already being used, but still under validation only. And xeno histogenicity and cytotoxicity, and acute and subacute chronic toxicity in earthworm and zebrafish. So probably I think they also will become the good alternate model for the rats over a period of time after the validation. Next. So now we come to the preclinical testing in India. Just another 5-10 minutes I'll take. So actually, as per the CPCC documents, there are more than 1,800. These statistics I have taken last year. There are more than 1,800 animal facilities are there in the country, and all these preclinical studies mainly conducted in CROs and the pharma industries. So right now we have more than 100 CROs actually, not 60 actually, it's more than 100, and pharma industries are also. It's more than 100 right now, and most of the preclinical studies are being conducted in these institutes. Next. And these are some of the pharmaceutical industries established in India and their location also, and they are having a well established animal facilities and doing a lot of preclinical studies. One is a Himalaya drug company, this was established in 1930, and next one is Cipla in 1935, Cadila in 1952, Rangaxi in 1961, and the latest I have not listed everything, so whichever is accredited, only those things I have listed here. And Shanta Biotech in 1993. Next. And apart from that, we have a lot of contract research organizations also in the country. Basically, they take chemicals or compounds from sponsors and they undertake studies and give the report back to them. So, JRSS Foundation was established in 1970. This is the first one, first CRO established in India. And after that, VIMTA. And so, these are some of the important. Right now, so we have. Around 40 plus GLP accredited CROs are there in the country, and more than 100 CROs are there, but they are not GLP accredited, but they are doing preclinical studies. And most of these are located in the southern part of India and western part of India. Next. And these are some of the list of GLP certified CROs in the country. I will not go in by, name by name. So there, next, there are 41 facilities have been accredited out of 50 facilities accredited by National GLP Compliance Monitoring Authority. Only after that, only 41 are using animals actually. Rest 9 are basically for physical chemical studies. Next. Okay, next. And apart from that, so I would like to emphasize here, in the last 110 years, 76 Nobel Prize for the medicine was given for the people who have used animal as a model system. This will, it will speak the contribution of the animal in the biomedical research, both for the human and the animal health. So that means, so almost more than 75% of the Nobel Prize, mainly because of the animal's contribution. Next. Okay, so that's all from my side. So if you have any questions, so you can ask.
Yes, sir. Thank you for discussion on this one, sir, laboratory animals. So perhaps your questions are available on the chat box. Shall I start asking, sir?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, sir. The first question is, can rabbits be one of the non-rodent species during preclinical studies, or is it mandatory to have dog or non-human primates or guinea pig as one non-rodent species?
No, rabbit is not actually considered as a non-rodent, so it's considered as a rodent only. So hence, either dog, non-human primate, or guinea pigs, as of now, is only considered as a non-rodent.
Okay. So the next question is, like I said, two participants have asked. One is, why two species have to be used? He is trying to explain, like, in the animal studies, more than one animal type is used to understand better about the compound being studied. How does this really help? Can you explain based on any particular example?
Why two species? Because the regulator, based upon the anatomical and physiological differences between the species, so, and also heterogeneity of the species. So that's ultimately the compound has to go to the human population. Human population is heterogeneous population. It's not a homogeneous. Whereas the rats and the mice, what we consider as homogeneous population, because we are breeding continuously and a lot of homogeneity is between the animals. So whereas in larger animals, homogeneity is very less actually. So heterogeneity is more. So that is one of the reason actually. And also anatomical and physiological difference. For example, non-human primates, if you take, their anatomy and physiology is more or less to human, almost 95% to 99% it matches to the humans. Whereas anatomy and physiology do not match non-rodent species to humans. So these are all various parameters they have considered. So that's the reason. So we require two species. One is more close to human beings, one is not close to human beings.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Next question is, for topical formulations, is it necessary to conduct preclinical experimental studies in the large animals like goat, sheep?
No. Now it's even rat and rabbit are also, they are trying to avoid all these things. Now alternate methods have come. Now artificial skin is available. So I think over a period of time, actually 2035, all these animal experimentation, European Union has decided to stop all animal experimentation. They are going only for the alternate methods. So even skin irritation, other things, right now we are using rodents, but large animals is not at all required. And alternate methods are also acceptable for this purpose.
Okay. The next question is, how to calculate in vivo dose of a compound on rats on the basis of a in vitro results?
No, dose is not calculated based upon the in vitro thing. Dose is always determined, so we have a OECD guidelines for that particular studies there. The dose calculated on that. So in vitro give you only the clue about the toxicity and other this thing, but those we will not calculate using the in vitro models.
Okay, sir. And next question is, can zebrafish or C. elegans be used and validated for drawing conclusions, as these are nowadays used as a common animal model in studies?
I showed, no, sir, they are still under validation. Probably, I think in another 2-4 years, zebrafish and C. elegans certainly. They'll be validated, and especially zebrafish. They are like in rats and mouse. They also have a lot of knockout zebrafish. This is specific zebrafish they have created already. So this can be used in future, I think, to avoid all these animal activist problems.
Next is for in vitro gene mutation study as per OECD guideline 488. Transgenic rats, sorry, it is in vivo gene mutation study. The transgenic rats or mice are recommended. How beneficial is this over in vitro gene mutation studies?
What is that question? Where is it? Is it?
What says the participant is asked in in vivo gene mutation study. As per the OECD guideline, it mentioned transgenic rats or mice to be used. Transgenic rats or mice.
Okay.
But how beneficial is this over in vitro gene mutation studies? In vitro gene mutation model.
Yeah, in vitro gene mutations are there. BRMT and so many other things are there. Yeah, we actually so, both in vivo and in vitro are there in gene mutation. So if you take that micronucleus assay, so we have to compare. So sometimes whatever you do it in vitro may not be directly extrapolatable. That's why we do in vivo also. So in some two studies, we have to do in vivo also. So for comparison purpose.
Okay. Yeah. So next question is IEC permission required for study to be done on zebrafish?
Yes. Yes. Last week they have if you go to the CPCA website, so they have uploaded the not zebrafish. Zebrafish will be uploaded soon. So birds they have uploaded already. Zebrafish maybe another month or so. So we are actually developing guidelines for that. So it's mandatory from I think up to 2 or 3 months.
Okay.
I think many institutions are not taking, but it will be mandatory, maybe in due course.
Okay, there are other question is like the specialist universities, they are doing research in fishes, like vertebrate fish. Are they need to take approval from IAEC for the research in their fish for specialist universities?
Absolutely, actually. So if you have the problem I'll tell you right now. If you have to publish the paper in international journals, they ask you the IAEC approval. Because there they don't differentiate in Western world. In India, so there is ambiguity. That's the reason people are still contemplating whether to take or not. But as I said earlier, in another 2-3 months, it will become mandatory. Everybody has to take approval for the fish also.
Okay, sir. What is the importance of ALAC for animal houses in India?
Basically for business. So actually animal care, they actually basically they do accredit facility based upon animal care, actually care and use.
Yes.
So to convince the sponsors from abroad that how well you are taking care of animals, so you have to follow the international guidelines. So ILAC is one such organization which accredit the facility for animal care and use. Whereas GLP is actually different. They acted for something else actually. But ALAC certainly helps in attracting the business.
Okay. And it is like C57 PL6 mouse is a good model for vitiligo studies.
Yeah.
Maybe.
I have no idea. Because the problem is, I'll tell you, there are thousands of C57 is a general strain. But there are thousands of models are available in the Jackson's website. So if somebody is interested in vitiligo study, I think they have to go to that particular website and do some homework. So certainly, I think that will give a good response if you use a specific model.
Okay. And I think one question is, do we actually need to redo the toxicity study for already proven drugs? If we are going to use this, I think he's asking for alternative purpose, alternative indication probably. So the participant is asking if the drug has to be used for any alternative indication, do we need to redo the toxicity study?
That's very very critical question. I don't think it is required because it's a repurposed drug, what we call it as. Drug is in the market for some purpose. So that means all the toxicity studies have been conducted, and then only the after proving safety of the particular compound, then it will be in the human usage. So again, there's no meaning in conducting the same thing again.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Right. So then next question is, why CPCSEA is not strictly implementing the in vitro study requirement before they approve the projects in the animals?
So, I think Dr. Suresh is there, I think, so he'll be able to answer there. Dr. Suresh?
Then many university has to close down.
What is the question?
The question is why CPCSEA is not strictly implementing the in vitro studies before they approve the projects in animals.
No, while reviewing the experiments conducted in large animals, they are seeing the conducting experiments in the smaller animals. But smaller animals decision will be given to the IAECA, the local institutional animal ethics committee. CPCSA does not come into picture. So before small animals are taken up for studies, the local institutional ethics committee will definitely ask whether there has been conducted or any other pre information is available, sufficient review has been taken up for the studies and all that. And they will ask those questions, right? What is your answer?
Absolutely correct. Actually, in Form B, so there is a specific column saying that whether this compound has been tested on alternate market. Most of the investigators say either no or yes. So the declaration what the investigator gives, we consider that one as a correct answer because they must have done some homework actually. So elsewhere, if it is done somewhere else, we consider that there's no need to repeat it again. So we consider that as taken, done elsewhere. But wrong declaration also is sometimes is problematic. Most of the time they don't do any homework. They falsely claim that it has been done elsewhere, and that's why they want to do it in animal studies. But actually, in the Form B, if you go through it, it's very clearly mentioned. So it has to be tested somewhere on alternate models before conducting in animals.
Yes.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Suresh, sir. The next question is, what are the institute or research center in India that are doing preclinical studies in non-human primates?
Right now, none actually. Only and the private, we have Zydus. And recently, CDRI also got approval for GLP studies. So probably, I think they may do in future. CDRI and Zydus Cadila in Gujarat. These two have non-human primates.
But if you please examine this, the testing facilities in Kasauli, they help preclinical drug toxicology and authorize on behalf of the government.
Yeah, but not on non-human primates.
They will not be directly doing the preclinical studies. Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, sir. Then why male animals are used more in research than female animals?
Okay, so this is actually still now under debate only. So to avoid any changes in the hormonal concentration, the drug effect on the hormonal changes, so that's why they are using male. But now recently, I think last year, there was one paper published stating that we have to check in both the species to misguide or to avoid any this miscalculation. So both has to be taken actually, but I think slowly I think they are going to change this also. Right now it's only male in some test actually.
Okay, sir. And will projects involving rats be approved or granted nowadays? I mean, because of the restrictions due to COVID.
But absolutely. You know, CPSA is meeting every month actually. CPSA, I'm talking about the last committee. Even IAC also online meetings they can conduct whenever there is a requirement. So CPSA has given clear instruction, you can conduct online meeting and take the approval.
Okay, sir. Yeah. As per CPCSE and Schedule Y, whether they allow dermatoxicity testing still in rabbits?
No, CPCSE is not a regulatory authority related to the drug testing actually. CPCSE is only for the animal usage and this one, prevention of cruelty to animals. But Schedule Y has guidelines for various things, so they can go to CDSCO website and they can check that one.
Okay, sir.
CDSCO has guidelines.
Yeah.
Skin testing has been banned, I think, no?
Yes.
No, actually, sir, still people are doing as per the OECD guidelines. Skin testing is, they are doing actually. Alternate models are more this one, preferred.
Gadget certification of Government of India is there already, CPCA. Gadget certification Government of India banned dermatotox testing in rabbits, the initial stages.
Okay, okay.
Now, Schedule Y is also not there.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Do we have to take IAC approval for birds and other ecotoxicity study animals?
Actually, if you go to the CPCC website or guidelines, it says anything above cockroach you have to take. So I think bird is above the cockroach, I think. So you have to take it.
Zebrafish, sir?
Zebrafish also, sir. Now we are making the guidelines. So that also have to, from next 2-3 months, it will be uploaded in the website. So after that, it will become mandatory. Right now, I think it's not mandatory, but I think it, once the guidelines are up, so it will be mandatory.
Okay, sir. And then there are a lot of questions. I will share your email ID to the participants, maybe considering the time, the webinar, and we'll ask the last question. So yeah. How CPCSC is focusing towards the 3R system, I just missed it. 3R program implementation through IAAC.
Actually, CPCSC it's a vast body. More than 1,800 facilities are there in the country, and it's very difficult for them to monitor. So that's why IAAC has been constituted in every institute. It is the responsibility of the nominee to see whether the 3R is being implemented or not. Because that's also very clearly mentioned, the forum B, whether we have to use the appropriate number of animals. All those questions will be there. So nominee and members should critically go through it, and then they have to, it is their responsibility basically. But CPCC once in a while give training to all these nominees for how to verify the forum bees and other things. So they have to take more interest, and they have to, because it's very difficult for CPCC to do monitor each and every institute this thing. So it's the responsibility of the IAAC and the nominees and the members of the IAAC actually. So basically, forum bees designed to take care of 3Rs only.
Yes, thank you so much, sir.
Srinu, I want to ask one question. Actually, it's not a question, it is a clarification only. But before that, I would like to congratulate Ramu for an excellent and wealthy, knowledgeable person he is. And it's a really very informative lecture. And he has so many beautiful slides with a lot of worthy. Notable slides. I hope you'll be presenting, sending us the presentation. It will be very useful for many people who are right now.
I got it from the public domain. Nothing is, no research is involved here, sir. Everything got it from, I can give it to you. No issue, sir.
We have obtained the permission from the Ramachandran, sir, that it will be video recording and it will be kept over ISBT. YouTube site.
Very nice.
So all will be benefited. It was very excellent, informative, and basic information covering every aspect. So I thank from the resident point of view. Thank to Ramachandran and all participants.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
There is, though the regulations are not there, stringent for testing of stem cells these days, many people are not subjecting the MNCs and the in animals before subjecting to humans directly. What is your opinion, and what are the best models do you think you can suggest in case if someone wants to test the stem cells in the model?
Sir, actually for stem cells, actually now that's also gaining a lot of importance. It has to be validated, sir. That's the problem, sir. For all studies, you can't use the cell lines, sir. We are using a lot of cell lines here. But again, many of them are under validation only. So unless you validate it, regulators will not accept that, sir. That's the problem.
Okay.
European Union is trying very hard to use all these alternate models, and maybe they have clearly specified after 2035, so no animal models for that testing.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks, Tom.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. And okay. As the president said, the recording of the webinar will be uploaded in the YouTube channel of ISVPT. Yes. So the participants can anytime visit the YouTube channel and then listen to that. Now may I request Professor Silas Bau, sir, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Srinivasan. From the society headquarters, I am highly thankful to Dr. Ramachandran for a nice presentation and interaction with the participants for the answering their questions. So once again, I am highly thankful to Dr. Ramchandran. I am thankful to Suresh Pothani of NRF Hyderabad, also Dr. N. Prakash in the audience, many participants from the industry like Dr. Darshan Goel from AcuPreg, and many others are there. And I am also thankful to all the executive committee members of the ISCPT. I am also thankful to all the live members of the society, as well as all the participants, those who have registered and those who have participated in this webinar. The society is highly indebted to them. From the organizing point of view, I am thankful to Dr. A.M. Thakur, President of the Society, and I am also thankful to my colleagues, Dr. Srinivasan and Dr. Ratnadeep, for nicely managing the webinar. Once again, I am thankful to each and everyone for making this webinar a success. The final announcement that next Saturday, we will have the a webinar on the topic Regulation of Vascular Tone by Endothelial Changes in Health and Disease by Professor Andrew Brown from Canada. So the registration link will be posted tomorrow, and all of those who are interested, they can start registering for this webinar to be on next Saturday. Thank you everyone once again. Dr. Srinivasan.
Yes sir, thank you so much sir. I think the feedback form link is given in the chat box. Those who are interested to get the e-certificate, please click on the link given in the chat box and then fill the form. So we'll be sending you the e-certificate within a week time to your email ID. Okay. So now may I request President of ISCPT to
Again, thanks to Dr. P. Sriram for presenting the author very nicely. I thank all the participants, and now Dr. Srinivasan, you are permitted to close the webinar.
Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you.